Information is very clear to you. But if say that somebody from other place, there is a chance to come, that is the uncertainty, and it contains lot of information that whether they are coming or not related with this. So uncertainty is not always bad in the sense. Sometimes uncertainty is also acceptable because it gives you lot of information. And you know entropy measurement for the information, probabilistic models are already there. Okay? So collaboration will be needed between patient and the healthcare practitioner. So the measurement of uncertainty, it is not just true or false, right? So scope to model this and reason over the shades of gray region, where is the uncertainty, you have to find in the world. So uncertainty is characterized by probability, like the likelihood of future event. Ambiguity, that is the multiplicity of possible states for a single concept or event. Or vagueness, that is also possible values on a continuum, is a fuzzy logic, can be also used here. So William Osler is a very renowned physician. He died in 1919. Okay, at that time, youth of course didn't see the light, myself also. But his word is very relevant, that he said that medicine is a science of uncertainty and art of probability. That means how to tackle the uncertainty. That is the art, that is the challenge. Okay. So inappropriate management of diagnostic uncertainty can impact both system and patient outcome. So is that diagnostic uncertainty? What is diagnostic uncertainty? Reality is that doctors, this is basically, it's the unfortunate phenomena for the world. Reality is that doctors continually have to make decision on the basis of imperfect, not so relevant data and limited knowledge, which leads to diagnostic uncertainty. This is the scenario. Okay? So our goal is to how to tackle this scenario, how to accept the challenge and to give a better information or diagnostic phenomena. Coupled with the uncertainty that arises from unpredictable patient responses to treatment and from healthcare outcomes that are far from binary. It's not yes, no type of decision. We can speak about so hypothesis in place of diagnosis. So it's not the true, false or exact this. So it's better to say that hypothesis in terms instead of diagnosis. So we'll go how to tackle this. So if you again that diagnostic uncertainty is another reason, patient symptoms change over time. You treat a patient today, after 3 days, he may be well, maybe the disease repeat or condition even worse. Okay? So it is the change over time making it difficult for clinician to identify a satisfactory explanation of the problem. Always the reason is not known to you. Okay, the medicine you provide or the clinician provide is becomes the it should be the improvement, but it says it's not. So there are other parameters, other factors which will be the reason for that. So time constant of the patient clinician encounter, because doctors have very limited time, limitation of diagnostic test because of money or cost influence the diagnostic decision. This is the real picture. So diagnostic uncertainty has been associated with diagnostic variation, change of physician and over testing. So how to deal with this? We have to go for technology intervention is there. So now I think it's clear why the uncertainty in medical domain, both from the side of doctors mainly as well as from the patient. Okay. So how to tackle with this technologically? So to develop highly accurate predictions, you require a gigantic amount of labeled data is required to train the underlying models. If we go for intelligence development by the machine or machine learning, so you of course need a huge amount of data. And not only data, data must be labeled. Label means its class level must be known, but it's very difficult. because we have two diagonals. So level we have to give, to provide. So our data is there, abundant amount of data is there, but without level. Labeling is the task of the clinician. Is it okay? So this is the data collection, and the labeling is a great hindrance for developing the machine learning model. And of course, the India has the other problem, that is India specific clinical data is also rare, because we are not very accustomed with the documentation. So before making a treatment decision, a physician has to evaluate the benefits and risk of additional imaging, if you go for imaging or laboratory test, and decide whether to ask for them. So before applying the, give them the notion for going to test, you must be, of course, will be very accurately, you have to predict that. Otherwise, you go, you give something for MRI, but it has no result. It is a plain. Because the patient is not related with the MRI imaging, but it is, cost is there. Okay. So whether we can able to intervene in this aspect. Value of information is a quantitative decision analysis technique for answering such questions based on a decision model. So we have to develop that decision model. So, first of all, whether the dynamic decision problem. Dynamic decision making under uncertainty concern, decision problem in which time and uncertainty are explicitly considered. So, for this, for example, say a common medical decision is to choose an optimal course of treatment for a patient whose physical condition may vary over time. Today you say that you go for this test, tomorrow maybe the condition has changed. So that test may not be relevant. So there is also uncertainty. So how to tackle this? So you need some dynamic decision model. So select a course of action that satisfies some objectives in an environment. So environment is very relevant for this. So dynamic decision problem differs from a static one, is the explicit reference of time is required. So a patient is either well or sick on the third day after being treated, representing the environment. Okay. Similarly, actions are context dependent, varying precondition, usually with respect to environment or time or both. Whether you will take any action means give some medicine, that depends on its previous condition. That is called the precondition. And that is the rule-based diagnosis is possible. A patient can go an open heart surgery, and surgery can only be carried out if the patient's physical condition is stable. Okay? So these are the, this way you have to go for dynamic decision making, and of course you have to consider, you have to represent the environment. So environment is the search space, you have to consider the action. Action may be the rule-based requirements, okay? So we have to do it for dynamically assigning this. So decision making under uncertainty is that given an initial environment, the problem is solved by choosing a course of action that optimizes the expected desirability. The decision are made in stages, not, and stage may also vary from patient to patient. Multiple objective decision, it can be treated as a multiple objective problem, this multi-objective optimization problem. And first, identify the task in dynamic decision making under uncertainty. For this, I do not know whether it is visible. If for each of these tasks, from the time is varying, so you have to define the environment, you have to define the objective, and you have to define the decision. So for each of them, for a single patient, time to time each of this environment changing time as time is changing. So time will be a reference point for diagnosis the decision in dynamic environment. Basically, we know that Bayes' theorem as the very probabilistic model, very much useful for uncertainty management. So just a little recapitulation of probability, that if I say that hypothesis instead of diagnosis, we are saying that hypothesis, probability of hypothesis 0 for evidence E. Okay, so evidence is given. So based on the evidence or observation, means based on the symptoms, whether you can diagnose or generate an hypothesis. Similarly, probability that E arises given that H0 has occurred, that is called evidential probability. Hypothesis is known to you, you have to check whether this evidence is for this hypothesis. And in this case, basically, it is the prior probability, H0 prior probability, and this is the evidential prior probability, probability of E. But basically, you have to collect a lot of uncertainty, a lot of evidence. Say, n number of evidence you must be there, as well as for you have to, because you are not certain about the diagnosis, so you have to n number of hypotheses. So, for each n number of evidence, for each n number of hypotheses, you have to collect a lot of prior probability. That is the main problem with this Bayesian model. So basically, using a collection of evidential and prior probability, compute the most likely hypothesis or disease, that is good. But thing is that collection of prior probability for evidence and hypothesis, lot of probability distribution, you have to assume or you have to tune it again. The parameters you have to tune. So for that, people cleverly think that the independence of evidence means they are mutually exclusive. If it is so, then we can just multiply them according to the probability rule. So E is a collection of some evidence, but if you make them as a combination of it, then there will be lot of combination. Say fever, cold, fever, nausea, nausea, cold. There are lot of symptoms can be combined for diagnosis, and that of course for a single symptom, it will be better if we combine more number of symptoms. Okay, so under such situation, if we think that they are independent, then it is very easy that E1 and E2 together for the hypothesis H, under this assumption, E1 and E2 will be just individual probability. Whether this is a reasonable assumption, we can try to avoid the data probability distribution, we assume there is the independence. But actually, real world, they are not independent, because a patient is suffering from fever and cold. Can we treat these two symptoms independently? Okay, whether it will give the better result if we combine them? We can avoid the assumption of independence by including a new is a very well known concept, that is called Bayesian method. So instead of Bayesian theory, Bayes theory, you can go for Bayesian network, where causality in our knowledge can be expressed in the network. It is a directed acyclic graph. From each node to another node, the causal relationship can be established. That is a very conditional, edges represent conditional dependency, but wherever it's not there, you just assume that they are conditionally independent. And to solve this again, we have to use the, you know, the chain rule, that is if all are the symptoms, so prior probability for symptom A, then if A is given, what is B, if AB is given, what is C, and so on. So using Bayes network, this way you can solve it problem. But main concern is that Bayes network is also required the level of the data. So it can be used any other field, but in medical domain, level of the data is not so easily obtained. Okay, because it depends on the physician, it depends on the environment, and so on. So we will discuss a new topic, which is called active learning. I think active learning is not only for medical science, maybe used for medical science, because level is an important thing. But it can be used anywhere where there is vast amount of data and very few you know the level. Most of the data you don't have the level. So our task is to labeling those data which are not labeled. okay, because without label we cannot we only go for similarity measure, but we cannot label them. So those are only labeled. How do you utilize those data for labeling unlabeled data? That is the aim of active learning. Is it clear? You have a lot of unlabeled data, few labeled data. I can use this labeled data based on some query or based on some annotator to label them. So basically, still what is doing, we randomly select some labeled data. And based on that labeled data, we may go for labeling the unlabeled data. But that will not be very helpful, because randomly selection means sometimes it will give good results, sometimes it will not give. So whether there is any way to take the labeled data cleverly based on some information so that this data is most informative or most uncertain also, you can say other way, for labeling those unlabeled data. That is the concern of active learning. And this is the different from the passive learning. In that case, it's not you are randomly selecting that data. Is it clear? So this is the goal of active learning. And since in medical science, say very few, a person has some tumor or cancer, so it's, of course, we also know that very few people has this cancer. So you have very less amount of labeled data. But most of other people who are coming for treatment, they have some symptoms, but their label is not started. We cannot say they are having this cancer. So they are unlabeled data, but they have some symptom, means they have attributes that they are not only labeled. Okay? But few are very started, because yes.
There is a set of data. You have labeled X N as a A, and you choose another data that's a B. So if you label that data as a, is there any relationship between labeled data and the content of the data?
Just I repeat your problem. It is that you say that some data is there, means attributes are there,
yeah.
Object is there with some label.
So
and then you,
is there any relationship between the label and the content of the data?
Content of the data means attribute.
Attribute.
Of course. Based on
then
that attribute, it is labeled.
If you choose the another set of data which has not been labeled, then you pick the data, and if you label as a, that will be any chance of misguidance?
Of course, that's why there is a cleverly you have to choose the labeled data. From the labeled data, you choose a very few which has certain parameters, certain characteristics. Okay, it's not, that's why they are not randomly choosing. I analyze the data which is already labeled, and there is also some query. It's not that I give that label to this label, maybe a different label. Those are labeled. Those are labeled. It's not that the new unlabeled data will be labeled with that. I can label also a separate one. Okay, but I have to gather some information on from the labeled data, because those are already diagnosed. And also there is a query, annotator, maybe a physician, who will give you some information.
So before labeling, that means I have to choose the some characteristics of that data.
Yes, I will discuss what is the strategy for this. Yes, sorry.
Is this a supervised technique?
It is a semi-supervised technique. Of course, it is not supervised, because supervised means all labeled data you have must have. But here is part of it, because supervised again has the problem, it may be the imbalance problem. Maybe say like some medical diagnosis, in case of 100%, 80% people are normal. So they are majority, and 20% is diseased. So there is the imbalance problem is also there in case of supervised. So if we develop a model, then of course there is will be a dominance. Okay, so supervised model has also this kind of problem. So main thing is that whether we can tackle this data for which have the equal representation for the total data set. That is not possible in the real world data. you always cannot say 50% will be class 1, 50% will be class 2 and so on. Maybe you discuss some of them in another question, loss of information. Okay. So, active learning is, of course, it is a semi-supervised learning. So, it is well motivated where unlevel data is abundant or easily obtained. Because you see the social media data, lot of people are saying so many things, okay. So, but they are not perfectly saying it. There is also probable chance of like this. So, abundant unlevel data is available, but leveling to them is time consuming or expensive. How do you level them? There may be some expert who can level them. Say for a text analysis, language, there may be some interpreter who can easily level them. But it is of course very expensive because you have to pay for that person, you have to pay the clinician, physician. Okay, so how to use this for to avoid this, right? So active learning is a special case of semi-supervised. Semi-supervised means where partially the level information is available. Okay, not all. So it is in the group of, and you know, unsupervised means no level data is available. So machine learning, where a learning algorithm interactively query. So query is the, how do you query, make the query, that is the strategy based on that data. The user for labeling unlabeled data instances by a human annotator. The human annotator sometimes may be a machine also, but in the medical domain, of course, machine will not be able to do that. There will be a physician who know about this, who can give the answer.